Thank you, thank you. That was all pretty good, but my son gave me a standing ovation. I think that was the winner. That was the winner. That was good. Awesome. All right, well, we are going to hit a really fantastic passage of Scripture tonight, and there's a good chance that you've read it and you've thought, oh yeah, wow, that's a pretty cool moment. That's a really good object lesson from Jesus, and thoroughly missed the point. And I don't want you to miss the point. This passage is rich, and if we can press into it, we'll discover its full power tonight. But beforehand, to get us in the groove, how do you get ahead in life? In the Western world, how do you get ahead? What do you think? Who's got some ideas? Pray. You guys are good religious Christian folk. In the Western world, I think the best way to get ahead is to have money. Is that right? The quickest way to get ahead would be to be beautiful, to have a really good image. Is that about right? Power. This is what we're told, isn't it? If we can amass power, if we can amass money, and if we can be really, really ridiculously good looking, we are going to get ahead. And this is what we're told in life. And of course, those things, how do we judge whether we've got enough power, whether we've got enough money, or whether we've got enough good looks? Well, the only way to judge is to look around us, isn't it? And we have to be better looking, more powerful, and have more money than who? Anyone we can see. Anyone we can see. And this is how the Western world builds itself up. We start off trying to beat the people around us. We want to judge them and we want to overcome them. We want to dominate them, right? And then we start to say we can feel good about ourselves and we're getting ahead. Now, the world has been like this for a very, very long time. And this system is very messed up system. It makes the world a place where most people have a bad life. Did you know that? Most people have a bad life. You'd think if that's the system, that all the really good looking, really powerful and really rich people would be trying to take each other out so they can work out who's the best, wouldn't you? But the truth is that really rich, really powerful, really good looking people, when they come across one another, they see each other and they realize, oh man, that's going to be a big battle. How about we just stay a little distance away from each other and keep feeding off all of these weaker ones? Have you noticed that? Because that's what happens in our world. Instead of the really rich, really powerful, really big people taking each other on, they say, no, let's just keep a distance and feed off the weak. And this system of domination and exploitation just grows and grows and grows. And people all over the world get ripped off, get hurt because of this bad idea. A bad idea. And it's so ingrained in our society that we don't even notice when it's happening. For instance, one of the things going on in our society at the moment is porn addiction. It's going right through our society. And one of the great lies of pornography is it doesn't hurt anyone. Have you ever heard that? And you can think that. You can look at your pornography in your home and you can think, well, this is not hurting anyone. I'm just getting my little kick here. I'm getting my little sexual outlet. I'm having my little high and I'm doing that and no one gets hurt. But of course, if we dig even a little bit deeper, we start to realize that exploitation is happening at a huge level. And I'm participating in something that is creating a snowball effect that's creating huge problems in our society. For instance, if you do any sort of digging and get to know the people involved in this industry, you realize there's so much brokenness and torment. And the other thing that's really messed up is with the proliferation of pornography, we've got a proliferation of people growing up believing that they not only should, but have a right to get whatever sexual desire they want gratified. And as a result, now the biggest illegal industry in the world is sex trafficking. Think about that. Now, if there's 20 to 30 million people in the world right now involved in sex trafficking, why is it? If there's that many illegal prostitutes, there must be a huge demand, isn't it? If the supply is so huge, the demand must be even huger. Like, how does this happen? And it's this system of exploitation. And down the very end of a system of exploitation is all these people who are being broken and abused and used and spat out by our society. And I don't know about you, but I hope as a Christian you think, ugh, I want to get ahead in life, but I don't want to be part of that. And tonight's passage, Jesus says, this is the way forward for you. This is the way for you to get ahead in the life following me. And it's a way where exploitation and dominating people ends. It ends. It's an amazing passage. Let's get into it. And the strange thing is that it seems like such a heavy topic, but Jesus teaches us through the mother of all awkward moments. Has anyone ever been in a really awkward moment? Well, this was like the mother of all awkward moments in the Bible. John chapter 13, 3-5, it's the Last Supper. They're in the upper room. It's all going on. Jesus did the triumphal entry. The crowds were all cheering. The disciples are thinking, "Woo, we've arrived. We're with the king. This is all going so well." And Jesus says, "All right, let's get this this dinner going. This is going to be a real special time." So, John chapter 13, let me read. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he'd come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal and he took off his outer clothing. Woo! Orkies. Isn't this the mother of all awkward moments? This is the big week. He's come in, the palms have gone down, the crowds have cheered, it's all happening. We get into the Passover and Jesus stands up and takes off his clothes. This is a seriously awkward moment. Not only that, he then wraps a towel around his waist and dresses like a slave. He dresses like one of the servants of the slaves in the room. And this is getting seriously awkward. Then he pours water into a basin and he begins to wash the disciples' feet. This is seriously awkward. Now, the way the story is introduced by John is tomorrow's the biggest day in history. He's going to be arrested and the ball's going to roll and he's going to be killed. King of kings and Lord of lords. Jesus knows that's all about to happen, so off he goes and he starts giving this amazing, strange object lesson to the disciples. Now, just a few days before, the disciples have a little argument. Do you remember their argument is? It's, who's going to get to sit beside Jesus in heaven? Do you remember that argument? Who's going to be the one with the most popularity, power, image, right? Who's the one who gets, and in the ultimate loser move, two of them get their mum to ask Jesus. Do you remember that? That's like embarrassing. Right through the history of the world, you're known as the guy who asked your mum to go and ask Jesus if you could sit at his right hand and left hand in heaven. Do you remember that? That or she's like the ultimate ballet stage mum. Hey, Jesus, I've baked you an apple pie. Do you think my boys could be sitting on the left and the right up in heaven? Is that cool? Who knows? But either way, these disciples were really interested in the prestige of being with Jesus. They were really interested. They might have said the right things, but deep down, they wanted to be the guys with the power. They wanted to be the guys who could grandstand and be the one. And in this great moment in history, Jesus is going to teach them a lesson, and he gets up, he humiliates himself, he embarrasses himself in front of them and does this lowly act. I was thinking about a time when I was embarrassed in public. I used to be a personal carer when I was sort of 17, 18, 19, 20, around there. For a boy, he was about 17 years old, 18 years old, but he had the mental age of a 7-year-old. So he was really simple. He'd had a major epileptic fit as a young man, and oxygen was starved his brain, and so he had issues for the rest of his life. And I'd care for this boy, and we'd go and just spend hours together. It was my part-time job, and I'd take him fishing. I didn't know what to do with a fish, so I'd always take him places where we'd never catch one. I took him fishing for 4 years. We never caught a fish. It was fantastic. And we'd do all sorts of fun stuff together. And over the years, I grew to love Brendan so much. Like, this kid, he and I just have this rich relationship.
And we just had the best fun together, and I really loved on him. He was intense to care for. Like, he'd get really angry, and he couldn't understand things. I remember one time he was angry because I was taking him home, and he just tried to get out of my car at like 50 miles an hour. Whoosh, just open the door, and I'm trying to hold him. Like, he'd just do crazy things like that. So you're all always sort of on edge with Brendan because you had to watch out what he was going to do. Once I was driving around a corner, and he was angry at me, so he just pulled on my handbrake, whack, and we, and his parents told me, just put him in the, what do you call the thing at the back? Trunk. I call it a boot. He said, just put him in the trunk next time. I couldn't do that. But one day, I'm hanging out with Brendan, this kid I love. The other thing about Brendan, I should say, is about 250 pounds. All the drugs he had to take just to function, just so he wouldn't have seizures and things, they made him balloon up. And so he's a big lad. He was big, he was tall, he was very strong. And so it was hard to wrestle him when I had to. But anyway, we're in the shops. We're in this big mall, like a big Westfield mall style thing. And we have them in Australia too. We have electricity and everything. And anyway, we're in this huge mall, and you know the sort of the big central corridors of the mall, how sometimes they'll periodically have like a little arcade game or a skill tester or things like that. So Brendan says to me, Steve, can I do one of these? Can I do one of these? And I'm like, yeah, mate, you can have a go on one of those. So anyway, he goes up to the skill tester and he does the claw thing. And lo and behold, he wins it. Like, he actually gets something. Now, for Brendan, this right here is literally the greatest day of his life. It's the greatest day. He grabs hold of me in this bear hug, and I can't do it into the microphone because you guys will literally get blown away, but he starts wailing and screaming at the top of his lungs. Like, he is just having supreme joy at this moment. Supreme joy. Holding on to me and just jumping up and down and going nuts, right, in the middle of this crowded mall. Now, I just mentioned my age before, 17, 18, 19, 20. I was still cursed by image at that point. And for a split second, I was so embarrassed, because everyone just stopped, because this kid was loud, man, he was loud. And then in my mind, in that split second, you know how you can think a lot in a few seconds. First, I was embarrassed, but then I thought, wait a minute. Am I going to be embarrassed about this kid, Brendan, who I love, for the sake of this crowd of people who I don't even know? And I started to think about Brendan, like, Brendan really wanted his license. And every week he used to ask me, Steve, when am I going to get my license? And every now and again it would dawn on him, this younger guy than him, he got his license. And he'd ask me again, when am I going to get my license? And I used to always have to say, you know, his parents didn't want to tell him that he wasn't ever going to get his license, so they wouldn't understand. So we'd just always say, oh, not yet, Brendan, you know. And it would dawn on him, how's this younger guy got his license? I haven't got my license. You know, Brendan used to be, like, continually confused in life. Like, life was really hard for this kid. Sometimes he'd put his foot through a plate glass window because he's just so angry and he couldn't control his body. And I'd take him away and we'd pray together and calm down. Like, here's this kid who's got a really tough existence, a really hard life, and he's just having the moment of his life. He's finally won something. And me, I'm going to trade that to look cool or to not be embarrassed. And I was like, I finally, you know, in those split seconds, I got my act together and I started jumping with him and I'm screaming as well. And, you know, the crowd just sort of goes like this. And the security sort of looked at us and then they looked at Brendan and they did the maths and they like settled down. And everyone stayed away from us. And we just kept on jumping and hollering and loud until he finally settled down. And it was this great moment. This is like the level of embarrassment that Jesus is just doing something totally inappropriate. And the disciples haven't understood that you think this is inappropriate, but Jesus left heaven to become a man. Did you know that? Like, they're freaking out because he's behaving like a slave. And they haven't even considered the fact that he left heaven to be born as a man. The scripture, one of the most beautiful parts of the Bible, Philippians 2, we think it's originally one of the first songs ever sung in a church, you know. It's recorded like a poem by Paul, but we believe it was actually a song. It says, "Who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness." When Jesus became a person, he already humiliated himself. He already took himself down to our level for our sake in an amazing and powerful way. And the disciples still hadn't understood that, so they were freaking out when he acted like a slave or acted like a servant. It's like, man, that's nothing compared to what he'd already done. So anyway, Jesus starts the washing of the feet, and he comes to Simon Peter, and we always love Simon Peter because he's so honest. I love Peter. He makes me laugh. He comes to Simon Peter, and he says, Simon Peter says to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And then he says, "No, you shall never wash my feet." Isn't that cool? Comes to Simon Peter, and he's like, "Lord, are you actually going to do this? Are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus is like, "Yeah." And then he says, "Nuh-uh, you are never going to wash my feet." Why does Peter say this? Because, you know, if Jesus washes his feet with Peter's worldview, what happens? "I'm better than you, Jesus." That's what he thinks. He thinks, man, if you wash my feet, I'm better than you. That's not right. And in his head, he's like, "This can't work. This can't work. You're not allowed to wash my feet." Because he actually loves Jesus. He's not being rude here. He's not like, you know, "You're not going to wash my feet. You know, I'm the cleanest guy in town." No, he's like, "If you wash my feet, I'm better than you. If you wash my feet, like, I'm over you." And that can't be right. Jesus says to him, "Unless I wash your feet, you have no part with me." And then Peter just flips it right around and goes, "Oh, it's truth. Not just my feet, my head, my hands, everything. Just wash me up, my whole body." And Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only wash their feet. Their whole body's already clean." Peter wants Jesus to be a hero. He wants Jesus to be like other worldly heroes. He wants him to be the guy with all the power, all the looks, all the prestige, all the position, the one who can dominate, the one who's up the top, the one who's in charge. And of course, like the other disciples, if you're close to that guy, you're in a good position as well, which is what their whole argument was about in the first place. I don't know about you, but if Tom Brady, the footballer, walked in here tonight, and we discovered that he was a spindly, skinny guy like me, and he had a weird, high-pitched voice, and he was really uncoordinated, kept tripping on things, we'd all be a bit disappointed, wouldn't we? Like, we sort of like our heroes to be good-looking and powerful and dashing and awesome and have sleeve tattoos that are, like, cooler than everyone else's, all that sort of stuff. And this is what the disciples still wanted from Jesus. But instead, Jesus gets up, strips off naked, takes on the persona of a slave or a servant, and starts washing their feet. Jesus continues. He says, "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." So if we're going to be like Jesus, we need to follow this example. We're not going to exploit and dominate people. We're going to be willing to humiliate ourselves to serve and meet people's needs. And this is a really amazing lesson from the Lord. It's a beautiful moment in Scripture. He is such an awesome leader. And he says, "Hey, if you call me teacher and Lord, you've got to do what I do. I voluntarily put myself under people in order to love them. That's what I do." And when we read this passage, often that's where we get to. And we say, yeah, Jesus is cool. He doesn't exploit people. He's willing to embarrass himself just to serve and love. He's awesome. And that's cool. But that is not the full weight of this passage. Now, one of the ways we know that is because Have you ever read another story in the Bible where the disciples washed anyone's feet? If it was such an amazing moment and he says, you've got to follow my example, why don't we read in Acts, 3,000 were added to their number and their feet were washed that day. We don't read that. You keep reading the whole of the book of Acts, you'll never find a single story about the feet washing. If anyone in your growth group or anything asks you to do this real spiritual activity, wash each other's feet, you don't have to. Thank you, Lord. It's just weird. It's just weird. I don't care if anyone convinces you. Why? If this lesson is that we are supposed to follow Jesus after he washed their feet, why didn't they ever do it again? Because that is not the primary message. We're going to flick back up to the start of the passage. There's a few little bits I conveniently left out. Bits that we might have just read over quickly if we're not too careful. And let's see what this story is really about. Starting at verse 3 again. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. John opens this story up and he says this is an intense moment. Doesn't he? Jesus knew that everything was under his power and he knows that he's returning to God. Like John introduces this story, he says this is a full-on moment. This is not a cool little lesson about loving people and being a little bit embarrassed in the mall, all right? This is not a lesson about treating others who needs and being willing to go underneath them and serve them. That is part of the lesson, but this is so much bigger than that. Look at that introduction. This is a massive event. So he gets up, he humiliates, pours the water, and he begins to wash them. He came to Simon Peter and he says to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus replied, and there's a bit I left out, you do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. Really strange moment. You do not understand yet. He says, look, I'm about to do this thing, and until I die and resurrect, you're not going to get it. I'm about to do this strange thing where I undress and I wash your feet, but you are not going to understand until later. And I reckon when John was writing this, he would have been like, oh man, now I get it. And he carefully writes it down. You don't realize what I'm doing, but later you will understand. Peter says, no, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answers, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Did you think that was a bit weird the first time around? Hey guys, I'm going to wash your feet. Your feet are a little bit dirty. Comes up to Peter. Peter, do you want me to wash your feet? No, this is a bit freaky, Lord. Don't do it for me. And then he says, oh, okay, you have no part with me. Whoa. Okay, wash my feet. Like, isn't that a bit weird? It's a bit intense. You see, he says, you don't understand what I'm doing. Comes up to Peter. Peter says, no, I don't want you to wash my feet. And his answer is, unless I wash your feet, you have no part with me. No part with me. Whoa, what is going on in this passage? Then Lord Simon Peter says, not just my hands, but my feet, my head, everything as well. Then he answers, those who need a bath need only to wash their feet, for their whole body is clean. Another bit I left out. And you are clean, though not every one of you. Oh, man. Jesus has washed everyone's feet. And then he says, not everyone's clean. Now, he didn't mean I did a bit of a sketchy job on James because he has a corn and I didn't want to touch it. He didn't mean that. We know what he means, don't we? He's washed everyone's feet, but Judas is there. Judas is there. And he says, guess what? The thing that you're not going to understand is the thing that's going to happen tomorrow. And when I die on the cross for everyone in the world, even though I've washed the feet of everyone in the world, some of you are not clean. Some of you are not clean. This is an intense moment where Jesus is teaching the disciples exactly what the Passover meal is all about. And we know in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus calls them, do this in remembrance of me. Eat and drink. This is my body. This is my blood. And at this Passover meal, in the book of John, we have Jesus dramatizing his death and resurrection for the disciples. He says to them, look, this is the thing that's going to happen tomorrow. This moment, you're not going to get it until you understand the cross and the resurrection. I have to wash your feet. I'm the one who has to do it. I have to be stripped naked. I have to be humiliated. I have to take on the role of a servant and a slave, and I have to clean every one of your feet. And he says, if you do not get your feet cleaned, you have no part with me. And then he says, I've washed all of your feet, but one of you is not clean. One of you is not clean. This is an intense moment of scripture. Jesus says, you will not understand. And then when he continues in the light of this, 13 verse 12 to 17, when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I've done for you? He asked them. And he knows the answer. He just told them they will not understand. It's not like he's asking them and go, I wonder if they've worked it out. No, he's saying this so that they'll remember. After the resurrection, they'll remember this amazing night. Do you understand? No, they don't. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I've done for you. Very truly, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them. Consider those words post-cross. You see, the disciples are sucked into the world's system of exploitation. And just like everyone else, they want position and power. They're saying to Jesus, right up to the last minute, do we get to sit at the right hand of the Father? Do we get a special position? Do we get to be above other people? And Jesus says, hey, guys, tomorrow, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Creator of the universe, is going to be stripped naked, spat on, maligned, rejected, dragged before two or three kangaroo courts where they just trump up ridiculous charges against the Maker of the universe. They're going to hang him on a cross, torture him until he dies. And all of that has to happen, because if it doesn't happen, you will have no part with God. You will not be clean. And then I'm going to resurrect, and new life is going to become mine. And you're going to be with me. And then you must do what your teacher has done for you, for others. Jesus doesn't call us to embarrass ourselves a bit and do some menial tasks to care for people. And that's why the disciples didn't go off to town after town washing people's feet. He says to the disciples, you also must lay down your life for the sake of others. And every one of those disciples gave their life for the cross. Did you know that? Everyone in that room died to send the greatest message of love to the world. This is an intense, powerful moment of scripture where Jesus calls us to pick up our cross and follow him. He calls us to lay down our life for others. He says the level of exploitation in our world can only be turned around by the gospel. And the gospel can only be transmitted by people who are willing to give up their own agenda, give up their own pursuit, give up their own way of life for the sake of someone else. Isn't this an amazing moment of scripture? And the reason when we have the Passover remembered, the reason that we have communion in almost every church service here is because we have to come back to that point at the cross every single day and say, Lord, everything in me just wants to fight for myself. I just want to dominate and exploit other people. I just want money and power and image and popularity. And if I get ahead and get stuff for myself, I'm going to be happy.
That's the sinful, selfish heart of mine. And every day Jesus says, come back to the cross and say, thy will be done. I will follow you, my teacher and Lord. You, the creator of all things, were willing to lay down your very life for me. And I now am willing to do the same by your grace and only through your Holy Spirit's washing and cleansing and power. But, Lord, I am willing. And that is what we're called to remember every time we eat and we drink. Not only do we receive the greatest act of love and grace and forgiveness, but we're called to step in and offer our own life and follow our teacher and Lord in the same practice and the same way. Matthew 10:8. I hope when you read this, it has more weight. It says, you freely received, so freely give. You freely received, so freely give. Jesus just stood up and washed their feet. So just stand up, he says, and give your life for the sake of others. How can we turn around exploitation? Only by laying down our own life. It's the only way. So two things, as the band gets ready to come out, I'm going to pray, but there's two things I want you to consider. There'll be decision counselors to help you. The first one is that you have to be washed by Jesus. Otherwise, you have no part with him. It's as clear as that, isn't it? When Peter said, no, no, he didn't say, oh, come on, Peter. He said, if you don't do this, you have no part with me. There's no other way into the kingdom of God. No other way. You have to let Jesus do his washing work. You have to come to the cross. You have to let him save you. You have to receive that. He's died for everyone in the world. But Judas was the first person whose feet were washed who did not receive it. And many, many people in the world have had their sins forgiven by God, but they will not benefit from that because they will not receive it. You have to receive it tonight. The second thing I want you to consider is Jesus says, are you greater than your teacher? Are you greater than your master? Are you more important than Jesus? Then follow his example. Lay down your agenda. Lay down your life to serve the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. If you need help with that tonight, because I know I need help with that every day, come receive some prayer. Ask God to change your selfish heart. If you're chasing after money and power and image and popularity, or if you still think it's fun to dominate people and exploit people, come and receive prayer. Ask God to change your heart. You can't will yourself into that. The Spirit has to come in and do his great work. That's what we need. Let me pray. Oh Lord Jesus, we thank you for this amazing passage. We thank you that you were willing to wash our feet. And Lord, we thank you that in the true washing of our soul, you are willing to go all the way to the cross, carry our sin, carry our shame, and free us from that, Lord Jesus. Lord, help us to receive your grace this evening. Help us to enter into that new way of life where instead of exploiting people, we will now lay down our life to serve and love people. Lord, help us not to serve and love the pretty people, but all people. Lord, help us to be humble, to humiliate ourselves, to meet the need you put before us, Lord Jesus. Pray that in your awesome name. Help us to do business with you tonight, we pray. Amen.